so many alumni here, awesome players and athletes we had here that are with us. They were all major contributors to the success of Watertown Athletics and our boys' programs and girls' programs as well. Players sitting up here tonight, from the JV varsity and even the IC players, can only hope that they can live up to the high standards that these athletes before them set and the cycle of pride in which they played and represented the school. So again, we want to thank all the alumni and special guests, administrators, family, relatives, whoever's here to honor Coach with us tonight. We'd also like to say a special welcome to Coach Delaney and the IC players and parents and fans of IC. We welcome you to Case Middle School and thank you for being a part of this special night. I had the opportunity to play for Coach, but more importantly, I had Coach as one of my mentors as a young coach starting out. One of my first few years, one of Coach's last few years, and I always looked up to Coach Gibley. I know we spent a lot of time in his Case office speaking, many long conversations about the game of basketball and people in general. And I know he taught me about certain things that I want to mention real quick. First thing was passion. Nobody had more of a passion for the game than Coach Gibley. And he pushed that out to his players, to myself, and Coach Adams, who worked with him, and all of us thrive on his passion. I still get goosebumps when I know players who talk to him. Every time he talks to us, we get fired up, still, after all these years. He also taught me about commitment, all right? Committing yourself to the program, to your school, and always believing in yourself and continuing to work hard. He also taught me about respecting the game. You take every minute, every practice, every second you're a basketball coach, you respect the game and work to get better and improve on it. And he also taught me, and I still to this day, my players are here probably shaking their heads saying yes, demanding maximum performance and effort out of your players every single minute, whether it was practice, games, summertime, all the activities we did, he always wanted the maximum performance. And I know I pushed the stride band on my girls, and the coaches here at Watertown, we all do that. And a lot of that comes from Coach Kibling's values that he taught us. So Coach, I want to say thank you first of all for myself, for all you've done for me. I only have one thing that I do want to get off my chest that really bothered me all these years, and I would like to give it to you. My little weight jacket. Successes now, family members of their sons that are doing great basketball. So congratulations to the whole family. It's a great family and a great tribute to Watertown and the athletic family. We have a few people that would like to say a few words to Coach Kimley. And the first one to call up is a 1974 graduate of Watertown High School. He was known for his many assists on the court during his time here at Watertown. No, I'm just kidding. But I want to introduce, first of all, Marty Lamb.
Well, first of all, I want to thank everybody for showing up and seeing a lot of the guys that we used to play with. And, you know, Lou Kibling put Watertown basketball on the map. As far as everything goes downstate, when we played in the Central New York Cities League, it was just unbelievable time of our lives. And, you know, our family goes way back. Louie and my father were good friends when they were growing up. And I always remember my father telling me the time that him and Louie, when they were 16 years old, took the train to New York City and spent the weekend down there. And I always said, what kind of parenting was that anyway? I mean, you just left for New York City for the whole weekend? Didn't your parents say anything? No, nobody said anything. I mean, I live two blocks away and get my kids a ride to school every day. And I still call them just to make sure they're not trying to pull anything on me. But anyway, get in shape for basketball. So being as dumb as I was, I said, yeah. So I showed up, you know, got a new pair of sneakers, sweatpants, and everything. This is great. So he says, you know, everybody get ready. We're going to run up to the park and, you know, to start off up Goldham Street Hill. I mean, where that we're going. So we left here and ran up to the top of the park up by the water tower back then. I'm like ready to die. And I'm like, wow, well, at least I made it. I guess this isn't too bad. And the coach shows up. He goes, this is where we warm up and do our calisthenics. So after that, you know, we ran our other 5 miles, I guess, or whatever it was. And we get back to the gym, and Coach goes, you know, you can go in and shoot some baskets if you want, or do whatever. And I said, no, you know what, Coach? I'm just going to vomit, and then I'm going to go home, okay? So we always, you know, Coach, we would do anything for him anyway. You know, I mean, I was there for 4 years, you know, even though I hated doing it, I was always there. You know, I ran 3 years of varsity, and 1 year of my senior year, I ran JVs because I was so committed. Yeah. But I'll tell you, me and Gary Matchaw had all the lunch money we needed that year. I'll tell you that right now. But it was just an honor to play for Coach. I mean, playing in the Central New York City's league against the guys. I mean, when I go to Syracuse and do business, the first thing those people will say to me, where are you from? From Watertown. You play for Kiblin? Yes. You know Jim Jerome? Yes. And then everything else, they want to do business. Well, I kind of figured it out because they respected Coach Kiblin so much, and they were scared to death of Jim Jerome, so they really didn't have any choice. But anyway, I want to thank everybody for being here, and thanks, Coach, for all the years. I mean, you've been like a dad to me, and you know we'd still do anything for you. We just really appreciate it. Thanks a lot.
Our next speaker is a 72 graduate of Watertown High School, one of the premier players of his era, and he's traveled in from Ohio to speak, so I'd like to introduce one of our best players of all time, Rob Little.
Well, I love you so much better than you ever remember being. You know, I don't remember ever being called one of the best when we were doing it. I want to give you a different angle on Coach Kiblin. Everybody knows about the coaching. Everybody knows about some of the records and some of the accolades he's had. But I just want to talk about Coach Kiblin, the father, and the sacrifices that he made with his own family and for others. My dad was killed when I was 7, and I grew up with a single mom that was 36 years old at the time when he was dead, with 6 kids. And I didn't have a route that I had planned out. It was basically just catch as catch can. And when sports came around, people found out I could throw a ball hard because of the winter up here. Threw snowballs year round, basically. And, one of the things that just came to light was the fact that I was getting tall, skinnier than I am now, of course. One of the things I'll never forget, the first practice Coach showed up. I was a freshman over at Case, this school, a lot different than it was then. And we used to run laps. Our social studies teacher, Mr. Woodruff, he didn't have a clue about basketball training or conditioning. We ran laps around the gym. That was our conditioning. And he looked at us and he said, what? He said, get out here on this baseline thing. He said, you know, get out on this baseline thing. And so we're all standing there thinking, okay, what are we going to do? He said, you're going to run down and back 10 times until in a minute, and if you don't make it, you're going to do it again. And I was, you know, maybe 135, 145 pounds. My feet were bigger than my legs, and I couldn't make 10 in a minute. And after the fourth, I think it was the fourth try or whatever, he got tired of watching and just said, you know, you'll get better. Sooner or later, you'll get it. And he left, thank God, because like Marty said, I think I went out the locker room, shoot my guts out, and determined and just questioned whether I really wanted to play basketball or not. But a couple guys got moved up to JVs that were freshmen, and I got to actually start playing, and some things happened. But the sacrifice we're talking about is the things that he took away from his own family to help some of us that didn't have some of the things that they had. Commonly known as two parents that were so loving. But Coach Kiblin grabbed me after our senior year, and he said, you're going to go with me this weekend. We're going up to Norwich University. And you're going to do a school visit to Norwich. I had no idea it was a military academy. We got the station wagon, we got up there. I think I got car sick twice on the way, but we got up there. And he dumped me out, basically said, here's the kid that's going to guide you for the weekend. And he was in a uniform. And I'm like, what are we doing? And he said, well, you're a recruit, so we're going to show you what we do here. Next thing I know, we're having dinner, and they're eating like this. And they're doing it real slow and deliberate, and if they didn't mind what they were doing or somebody didn't do what they were supposed to be doing, they were down doing push-ups at dinner. And I was like, this is not where I want to play basketball. But Coach took the whole weekend out of his life at that time to ride all the way up to Norwich. What, Vermont? Is that where it is? I think. I try to put that in my head. But it was one of those things where I thanked him, and my mother told me to thank him again, because there was nobody in our family that was ever going to drive all the way to Vermont. And I thought, you know, I didn't end up going there, but the bottom line is, there was nothing that I had going for me beyond that. And it just taught me really the whole meaning about sacrifice, because I know he left his kids at home, and there was other times that he done things for us. And quite honestly, it's one of those things that it's a lifelong memory. And as far as the 10-minute thing goes, there's not a one of us right now that if we were able to do it, that we wouldn't love to be back on that line. Because that's where really it's all started. And I'll never forget him telling us, this is the best condition you'll ever be in your life. And I thought, I hope so. Coach, love you, and can't thank you enough.
This next gentleman, this little guy right here, just recently was named to the top, I believe, 35 best football players ever in Central New York. He was a graduate of Watertown High School in 72, played at Syracuse University. I had the pleasure of playing 1 year at River Plate with him the first year, and I was 18 years old. He has just graduated from Syracuse and played against major people. I appreciate you never throwing me, just putting me down nicely all the time. All right, but I want to introduce Jim Jerome.
Good evening, everybody. Thank you for coming. Bear with me, this is tough. Before we get going, we got a lot of thank yous to get out first. To the Board of Education here, a huge thank you. To Athletic Director Mike Lennox, Eric Schofield, and Jerry Levine. Give yourself a hand. This is a little bit awkward in that Coach left in 89, but why are we honoring him now? Because he got the wonderful, tremendous award for the Hall of Fame years later, and many of us didn't think that he should just ride off into the sunset. So that's why we're all here today. This is a very small sampling of the lives that Coach taught. And I'm not here because I was any great basketball player. I'm not going to try to con you. There's no highlight footage of Jim Jerome, believe me. I was more than mediocre at best, but like Robbie Malone, Coach touched us all in different ways. I can do this, stick with me. Recently I heard a young sports writer go up to an old veteran coach, kind of like Coach Gibbon. Preseason, he said, Coach, how are you going to be this year? The coach looked at him and thought for a minute and said, I honestly don't know. So what do you mean you don't know? Come on, I got a deadline. I got to write an article. Help me out here. You were pretty good last year. You're going to be the same, better, worse. What's the deal? He says, okay, I'll give you an answer. He said, You come back and ask me in 20 years. 20 years? What are you talking about? And the coach said to him, he said, well, in 20 years, I'll be able to tell you what kind of men these gentlemen became in our community. Were they successful? Were they good fathers and husbands? Did they give back to the community? Did they contribute? Because coaches are so much more than coaches. They're like a Mr. Fix-It. They can do it all. I mean, kids don't go to their math teacher when you have a problem. You go to your coach because he's a psychologist. He's whatever you need at the time. He's a problem solver. And that's kind of what Coach Kilting was to me. Like my great teammate, Robbie Malone, who was the inverse of me as far as scoring. Coach was special to me in that I lost a parent just as I was entering high school. And I needed that extra crutch. And Coach Kibley was there for me. He was that crutch. And to be honest with you, some very dark days. And I've never before said this in public, but I might not be here today if it wasn't for Coach Kibley. I might be only a little memoriam in front of a yearbook somewhere. So that's why I get choked up and say what I do and feel the way I do about Coach. A very, very special man, as all coaches are. They work in the greatest classroom in America. There's no book, there's no video, there's no cheat sheet. It's their DNA that they impress upon other young kids. And coaches' DNA is spread throughout this great state in this room today, or we all wouldn't be here today. So I'm going to probably say this over and over, be a little repetitive, but I'm going to say the phrase, pass it on. And Coach rubbed off on all of this in some fashion. And like everybody, when you leave here tonight, pass it on. All those great gifts that you were given to by a coach or a teacher or whoever, pass it on with them, because that's our job in life. Be good citizens and give back. And Coach was all of that and more. He was very special. And no nonsense. When those doors were locked and practice started, I thought we were going to shut it. I said, what do you mean the girls can't watch practice anymore? That was the end of that. I mean, it was all business with Coach. We loved him to death. And through the sacrifice, makes a great character. You look around, look at his family. We're crying out loud, what a great family. Look at all they've given back to other young athletes in the community. And the ball players and athletes, I mean, it's something like no other. Coach Kibling came here from Lalo. He was like a white tornado. I'm telling you. Everybody remember the old Bugs Bunny cartoon? They had the, Tasmanian devil that would come in, swirling around, biting everything, and dust flying, and just growling and all that. I mean, and that's a compliment, Coach. Don't take it wrong. Believe me, in my world, that's a compliment. You were kind of like a race car. I guess I'm not a race car guy, but they tell me they've got an in and out box. You're either in gear or you're out. And he was always in gear, and that gear was full bore. Believe me. Yeah, he was a mixture of who to be. Probably General George S. Patton over here, but just a sprinkling of John Wayne. Some days a little more Wayne than Pat, but mostly Pat. And that was Coach. I mean, tough hide, tough bark,